Good afternoon and welcome to the Foreign Press Center. My name is Erin Eddy. I am a Foreign Service Officer, and it is my honor and privilege to welcome you here today and also welcome our guest panelists who are here to talk with us about the 25th anniversary celebration of the Americans with Disabilities Act, the ADA. To my left is Derek Coleman, who is the NFL Super Bowl champion, who is the first legally deaf fullback. We welcome Derek today. We welcome his father, Mr. Derek Coleman Sr. They are with the No Excuse Foundation, and you will be hearing about their work. We welcome back to the Foreign Press Center with pride our Senior Advisor for International Disability Rights, Judith Heumann. She is one of America's great civil rights leaders and disability advocates. And we also are very honored today to have Ann Cody, who is a U.S. Paralympic athlete, and she is a sports diplomacy expert. Welcome to our panelists.
Thank you.
And I would like to give you the chance. We're going to start with opening remarks from our panelists. We will have a chance to take questions from the audience. When you have a question, please indicate with your hand, and I will make sure that the mic gets to you. And so welcome, everyone. Judy, we'll first turn the floor to you.
So I was really thrilled when I heard that Derek was coming and that we were going to be able to do this panel today. And I am not a fullback.
You can be, though.
Yeah, probably. My mother was an avid athletic follower. And my father was not as much, and I think I was more like my father than like my mother. But one of the reasons for that was sports stadiums were not accessible when I was growing up. So the ability to really go and watch sports or to participate in sports was really something I didn't do. My brothers were involved in baseball teams and other things like that, but I was kind of a passive observer. So I think one of the important aspects of the Americans with Disabilities Act is it really has been changing so much in the United States. Our stadiums now are accessible. There's a great deal of work that's being done to get disabled people to be able to participate in sports and to be able to look at the entire industry of sports in a much different way than we really were able to do that in the past. A week and a half ago, my husband, who also has a disability, and one of our nieces from Mexico is here, and she had never been to a baseball game. And so we were able to take her to a baseball game. I know, not your sport. But at any rate, it was really great because here I was explaining baseball to her. Of course, my husband did a better job, but it was great. And it was a real opportunity for us as a family to be able to be doing something together, something which I didn't have the opportunity to do before. My first foray into international sports was in 1972 when I went with a group of people from the United States for the Paralympic game that was being held in Germany. And that was the first time that I had ever met disabled individuals from around the world who were coming together in Heidelberg to participate in the Paralympics. And it was a wonderful opportunity for me because although my family are immigrants, I had never really met lots of disabled people from other countries. And so this really was the first time that I was really able to get a much clearer understanding of some of the issues that disabled people were struggling with around the world. Mm-hmm. And for me, what was very important about that was whether it was a rich, middle-income, or wealthier country, the issues were very similar. If we looked at the issue of sports, clearly at that point in time, the Paralympics were really relegated to a sideline. The Olympics at that time were in Munich, and then the Paralympics were in Heidelberg. So you could see there was really no connection at all. And we've really come an incredibly long way so that people like Derek and others who have disabilities and are playing in various other sports, really it's becoming less common that it's just a few disabled people. And Paralympics and other sports activities are really helping to advance that. And I thought, Ann, you want to share a little about your work?
I'd love to. Well, I'm fortunate to be working at the State Department in our Sports United division where we do sports diplomacy work. And I bring about 20 years of experience in the sports industry to this job, and also experience as an athlete. I'm a three-time Paralympian and gold medalist in wheelchair racing. And as I said, I've worked in the industry, also participated in volunteer leadership work with the Olympic and Paralympic movement, really to help address some of the inequities that we were experiencing when we were athletes, to really make a change for the positive, and using legislation like the Americans with Disabilities Act to advocate for rights and more access, particularly for young people with disabilities, because they weren't getting the opportunity in school or after school to learn about and participate in sports and just be physically active at a very basic level. So we've seen that change dramatically in the last 25 years as well, those opportunities. And in Sports United, we work with athletes like Derek and Olympic and professional and Paralympic athletes, sending them overseas to our embassies and posts to do programming with youth, to get them engaged with the embassy and learning about American sports and values, particularly the rights that we have here as persons with disabilities. But we do sports all over the world. We also bring sports visitors here to the U.S., again, youth and coaches in a variety of sports, and they visit different cities throughout the country and really get the experience of our sports system through our public education system, and just learn about how American youth engage and what they like to do in their free time, as well as what they do at school. So those are some of the programs. We also have a focus on empowering women and girls through sports. So we have quite a few programs every year that focus on that. And the Sports United has been doing disability-related sports programming really since its inception in the early 2000s. And so we continue to do that today. And this year, we've really provided some new and exciting programs around the anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. We're really proud of that.
Fantastic. Thank you, Anne, and thank you, Judy. And now I'd like to give a chance to the Colemans to tell us about your work and what you're doing with the No Excuse Foundation.
Well, thank you guys all for having me. Well, when I first got out of high school, you know, I was very fortunate enough to, you know, go to UCLA and play college football. And I started noticing something, like, you know, all those accomplishments I had, but I'm still doing it alone. And I know that I'm not alone, because I get to college and there's a whole group of kids who are hard of hearing or have some sort of disability, and they all say the same thing, that they all felt alone too. So first thing I did was, I remember going to my audiologist, my mom, my dad. I was like, okay, I need to find a way to maybe go back to a high school and local community or something, and just talk to them, make sure that they're all one family. They're not going through these hard times, these obstacles alone. You know, some of them don't have the support system like I did. And you know, I remember going back to a school where there were 15 hard of hearing kids that didn't even really even know each other. And it blew my mind, because I always said that if I met another hard of hearing person, he's gonna be my best friend, or she can be my best friend. You're not going anywhere. And to see 15 of them not even knowing each other, it just blew my mind. It's like, okay, something has to change here. You know, we're all going through the same thing, and you guys want to go through it alone. So I started bringing them. Okay, what's the common denominator? They're all playing sports. Most of them trying to play football. They want to play sports. And I went to them like, hey, I'm nobody special. I'm exactly like you, and I did it. You know, and I got a full ride to UCLA, not only for sports, but for my education. And I let them know, like, I didn't worry about whether people said I couldn't do it, or whether my hand is going to break or anything. And I what I always tell them is, sports is the best thing that I prayed everybody. I prayed the person who invented football. I prayed the person who invented baseball, basketball, because it's the one thing, when you step in between those lines, the only thing that matters is, can you get the job done? Doesn't matter where you come from, doesn't matter what the color of your skin is, doesn't matter what ethnicity, whatever it is, but can you get the job done? You're playing baseball, can you hit a home run? You're playing football, can you knock somebody out and get many points? You know, you're playing basketball, can you dunk and can you shoot three-pointers all day? You know, can you get the job done? That's what they're judging you on, not whether your disability or whatever it is. they judge her based on how fast she can go in the wheelchair. And like they didn't care about I'm gonna go home and watch it. And I'm gonna judge her based on that. You know, it doesn't matter where she come from, doesn't matter how much money she has. You know, we judge purely on that. We wanna know, can I have fun with you and can I win with you? And that's what I made the No Excuse Foundation. So there's no excuses for not going and having fun, not doing what going for your dream, doing what you want to be. And not there's no excuse for not being you. Don't worry about what the person next to you is doing or what the person next to you wants to be when they grow up. Worry about yourself because it's already hard enough. Everybody here has problems. Nobody here is perfect. You know, that's why the second part of the No Excuse Foundation is the anti-bullying. You know, if I have a problem and she has a problem, why am I gonna, who am I to judge her on her problem when I have my own issue? You know, and people don't see that. And it's like, I have a problem. Well, come in, we have a problem. Which is, I'm gonna help you out, you help me out, and we'll all have fun. And that's what I'm trying to bring awareness to. Mm-hmm. And with the help of my dad, and with the help of my parents, my mom, I'm just able to be successful.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Well, we are glad that you're here today sharing your message. Mm-hmm. And we're also honored to have your father here with us. And we'd like to give Mr. Coleman and Senior a chance to speak as well.
All right, and again, thank you guys all for having me here. It's a pleasure and an honor. I'll talk a little bit about a parent's perspective and raising a child, you know, especially that wants to play sports that has a disability. You know, how do you do that? So as a parent, you know, we're protective of our children. But sometimes with that protected, we tend to hold our children back. Like, let's talk about Derek. You know, he wanted to play football. And I, as a youth, I played football in high school, and I know what a violent sport football is. So I'm thinking, well, there's no way my kid with a disability wears hearing aids is going to play football. How is that going to work with the helmet and the collisions? So it's something that really, that Derek's determination and says, hey, this is something I can do. So as a parent, you know, we need to let our children do that. And matter of fact, we need to encourage our kids to participate, you know, a la the No Excuses Foundation. We need to promote whatever they want to do. If it's skiing, basketball, whatever sport and activity they want to do, please encourage your kids to do that. And you'll see that, you know, they may have some challenges, but, you know, with time, effort, and determination, they can overcome those challenges.
Fantastic. Now, I want to share, thank you for sharing those perspectives. Judy and Derek, you actually have something in common. You both have very outstanding American parents. And Judy, I'm wondering if you'd like to share a little bit about the role that your parents played in helping you in your start with your experience in the New York City school system.
Well, I think it's fair to say that most, not all, but most disabled people who had our disabilities when we were younger had parents who were supportive. Mm-hmm. And where that wasn't the case, it's great that kids have been able to kind of go beyond that, but overprotective parents who really don't encourage their kids to move forward, it's more difficult for them. My parents were, I think they recognized, I had polio in 1949, so I was 18 months old, and a doctor at one point when I was about two, apparently suggested to my parents that I be put in an institution. And my parents decided, I was the first of three children, that they were gonna raise me like they were gonna raise my brothers. And of course, it wasn't exactly that easy because I had many barriers that were placed before me and millions of other disabled children at that time in the United States. This was the 1950s now, and when my mother took me to school, I was denied the right to go to school because I used a wheelchair. And the Board of Ed in New York City sent a teacher to my house two times a week for a total of 2.5 hours a week of education. And it wasn't until I was 9 years old that I was able to start going to school, but they were only classes for children who had disabilities. Now, I can't walk, and I couldn't walk then. So it wasn't, you know, the schools were not accessible. So that was one of the big barriers. If the schools would have been accessible, then like many parents today, my mother would have been able to insist more on getting me into the school. They were also immigrants, and so there are many immigrants in the United States. They were learning about what their rights were, and at that time, in the 1950s, we had no ADA, we had no Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, we had no federal legislation that gave rights. So my parents kept fighting to try to get me into an appropriate program. What my parents did do, though, is when it was time for me to go to high school, at that point, any children who used wheelchairs were supposed to go back onto home instruction. But my mother organized with a bunch of other parents, and they were able to get the Board of Ed to make schools, high schools, accessible in all of the boroughs. I didn't go to the high school where my neighbors went to. I went to another high school in Brooklyn. But at least I was able to go to a high school where most of my classes were with non-disabled children. And that was very important. I think, you know, one of the points that Derek was raising earlier about, in this case, hard of hearing students in the same school who didn't know each other. You know, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act is a fantastic piece of legislation because it really is improving educational outcomes for disabled children. But one issue that we're working on, and much more work needs to be done, is to really help ensure that children who have disabilities have opportunities to meet other children with disabilities, so that peer contact can occur earlier on. Because it's difficult in many cases for disabled kids, because it's difficult being a kid, just in general, and you want to conform and you want to fit in. And so I think that was one of the great reasons that when I was able to finally get into a high school that had mainly non-disabled children, it was difficult also because I'd never been in a program with all mainly non-disabled people, but it was a really good opportunity for me to begin to prepare for what the world of work was gonna be like and what life in general was gonna be like. Anne?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point. I really love Derek's point as well about how we can display that we can get the job done. Sport is a great medium mm-hmm. for doing that, for demonstrating our abilities. Mm-hmm. It's also a great convener. Mm-hmm. It's where I met the disability community. It's when I found a wheelchair basketball program at the University of Illinois, I found my family, a community of young people who
had you become disabled?
Who had the same experiences. I was 16 years old. So I had a lot of friends. I had a great support system, like both of you described. So that was really important ingredient mm-hmm. of my success academically and then through sports and then professionally.
And yet the role of your parents?
My parents were very active in advocating to my school system that I return to my high school after I finished rehabilitation. When I acquired my disability, I had paralysis due to transverse myelitis, so I was required to be in rehabilitation for about 4 to 6 weeks. And then I was ready to go back to school. I didn't want to be in the hospital anymore. I wanted to get back to living my life. So it was a very quick turnaround, and my parents pushed really hard to make sure that I could return to school with my teammates, with my classmates, and in my hometown.
Fantastic. And Derek, you are actually one of what we call the ADA generation. That you have grown up with all of the benefits of the Americans with Disabilities Act, mm-hmm. that Judy's parents were truly some of the pioneering trailblazers to start that process in motion. Would you like to tell us about your experiences in school?
I'm grateful that the act was established way before, before I got to school. Because yes, on that aspect, it was a lot easier. Mm-hmm. You know, we had FM systems for me to hear better. There was different types of devices, technology out there for me and for other disabled kids. Mm-hmm. And like school-wise and all that, I never had any problem. I think what came hard was now we fought so, we can make schools accessible. We fought for all that, but now we need to bring awareness to it. Mm-hmm. Because as a kid, I can't even count how many times people come up and be like, hey, what's that thing in your ear? They don't understand it. They see that I'm different. They see that I'm holding back because I know I'm different. and they try to take advantage of that, but they don't understand it either. And that makes me want to just step up. Like, if you don't, like, you're making fun of me, it makes me feel bad about myself. And, but at, over time, you know, all these events that are happening with the, you know, Disability Act, and years go by, and people start aware, like, hey, they just want to have fun too, you know. And I remember my dad and my mom always telling me how everybody has their own problem. They don't want to have to worry about your problem too, you know. And they didn't treat me any different, like she said, they didn't treat me any different than they treated my brother and sister. Matter of fact, they probably treated me harder because they want me to, for times like now, they want me to be able to go out and be able to function in the world. They want me to be able to interact with everybody without having an excuse, without being shy or whatever the case may be. And not a lot of kids, you know, have, you know, parents like all we have. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I'm trying to make it my duty, or was trying to make it our duty, to bring the awareness out there, because the act ain't going nowhere. It's gonna be there for another 25, 50 years, for way, when all of us are gone, it's still gonna be there, you know. But I want the awareness to be, that has to take a whole nother level, because there's still kids to this day that are going through the same thing that I went through, and that was 10 some years ago. You figure we'll overcome the barrier, but it's still happening. Mm-hmm. So the more awareness we bring, the more attention we bring, and it's really just by relating too. You don't have to be hearing impaired to relate to what I'm going. I can relate to all the trouble she went through, and I can walk, and I'm able to do all that. She can hear, and you know, she could still relate to me, because we're going through the same problem. You know, we have to overcome all these barriers. And actually, let me rewind that. We're not overcoming it. I don't like to say overcome barriers, because sometimes it's not worth it. Mm-hmm. Somebody put a barrier in front of me, I'm gonna go around it. Why do I need to go over top of that? You know, life is already hard as it is. Why do I need to do that? And it's had nothing to do with me. Just because you put it there don't mean I have to go through it. Mm-hmm. You know, we all have our dream. That's the path we should take. So we overcome the barrier to our dream. We don't overcome the barrier that other people put to make it hard on us.
I was wondering, what kinds of questions do deaf and hard of hearing kids and other kids ask you when you're going in and meeting with them? Are there some questions that they ask you that where you can share your information about who you are?
They always ask, they just, that's what, so I made a book called No Excuses. You know, I had to go through it, I told them my story. Mainly, I didn't write it because of book sales. I didn't write it to be number one. I wrote it as a reference point. Because what they always asked, and what parents always asked my parents, what was going through your mind when all this was happening? Mm-hmm. Like, okay, when the kid was picking on you, what did you do? Like, what was going through your mind? Did you just want to punch him? Did you just want to run and cry? Like, what was going through your mind? And I would always, that was a repetitive question. It wasn't, oh, what kind of hearing aids do you have? It's, how did you overcome it? Or how did you go around it? What did you have to do to get to where you are now? And I mean, the bus is just saying, hey, this is my mentality. This is what I went through. It doesn't matter so much about what she thinks about me, or what he thinks about me, or what anybody here. It only matters about what I think about myself. You know, it's a lot of, I actually tell kids, there's roughly about 7 billion people in this world. You know, how are you going to let any of them affect how you feel about yourself? You know, that's what it calls self-esteem. I'm not going to let, if I feel I look very good today, then I'm not going to let any of you guys can all tell me I look ugly, and I'm not going to listen to you. Because I have confidence that, you know, I got dressed and I'm looking
you
good
look
today.
Great. You look
thank
great.
You. You know, and it's really just, but it takes a lot of time for that. It takes a while for that confidence level to be. And in order, I was fortunate enough to have the support system to help me build that confidence. And I always tell them, like, it don't always have to be your parents, it don't always have to be your family. Surround yourself with people that want you to see more than you want to see. Mm-hmm. You know, I got a best friend back at home that pull me out of bed at 2 o'clock in the morning just to go lift, you know, because they know that I want to be the best I can be. And, you know, I do the same thing for him. Whenever he's tired, I'll be like, no, we have to go get better, you know. And he doesn't have no hearing impairment. He has other problems, whatever. But we both know that in order to be the best, you have to put the hard work in. And
part of it is asking the question also. So I was a teacher in New York for about 3 years, and I had sued the Board of Ed to get my teaching license because I was denied my license specifically because I couldn't walk. And the first year, I taught children with disabilities. Mm-hmm. And towards the end of the year, we were having a lesson on what do you want to do when you grow up. And so, like, most of the kids said they wanted to be a teacher. And none of them previously had ever thought about wanting to be a teacher. Mm-hmm. So it was great that they were thinking about college and getting a job. Mm-hmm. And so I was wondering also, do any of the kids that you talk with speak about how they could become a football player?
Oh, yeah. When you see somebody going through the same thing you're going and they already reached it, it's like, okay, if he did it, I can do it. Mm-hmm. You know, and I tell them all the time, I'm nobody special. I'm just a guy that just wanted to go out and have fun. You know, but I always tell them, it had nothing to do with me. It had everything to do with you. How bad do you want it? Mm-hmm. You know, if you want to be an Air Force pilot, but you can't definitely hit well, I'm pretty sure technology is out there. You just have to find a way. I wanted to play football. Not many people with hearing impaired can play football, you know, but my mom, my dad, they found a way to make my dream come true. And I keep telling them, it starts with them. You know, you have to determine what you want. And that's why I always go back, because I have to show them, like, hey, I'm nobody special, and yet I have 2 rings for football. She's nobody special, and she got 3 gold medals. You know?
1 gold medal.
Oh, one?
Only one.
Oh, okay. Well, then one more than I have. You know? And we're just out here, we're just living our life, we're just doing the best we can possibly be. And so there's no other way. Most people think, oh, there's a secret pathway. You have to do this, you have to do that. It's very simple. Yeah. Just work hard and control the things that you can control. Your attitude and your effort. Everything mm-hmm. else will take care of itself.
I'm so excited about the opportunity that you have and about the young people with hearing impairments and other disabilities mm-hmm. who see you and the great role model and great football player that you are. The message that sends to them and what's possible in their life, whether it's in sports or sports broadcasting or any field at all. So I'm just thrilled to get to know you and hear about your powerful voice. You know?
What did you major in school?
I major in political science. Mm-hmm. It's kind of funny because we're in Washington, D.C. Do I want to go that route? Maybe.
I promise that I would keep working on you
and who knows where you'll be next. Well, with that, I think that we should open up the floor to our audience for questions. Before you ask a question, please wait to receive the microphone. And we're happy to open up the floor. So if anyone has a question, please indicate with your hand.
And give us your name.
Greetings. My name is Tamira Lawson. I'm a disabled veteran. And I just want to thank all of you all. You are special. You're doing some amazing things. Derek Coleman, you're doing something amazing. And I was with your medals this weekend. You're amazing. Everyone on the panel. But I'm just going to say something here, and I'm going to ask a question. So as I mentioned, I'm a disabled veteran. And I found that there were many challenges after serving, after being injured. And my question is, So what are some of the major issues you faced in your journey to continue to be competitive and continue to that next level with your athleticism? And/or what do you foresee are some major obstacles for persons with disabilities? And if you have some ideas on how to overcome those challenges, it'd be great if you could share that. You all mentioned a lot of you that have a strong family, and not everyone has that though. And I was able to overcome some challenges, but I did it really by trial and error and a lot of failure, and then to be successful. So if I could just hear you, if you could mention that would be good, as how you were able to overcome some of those challenges, or what do you see are some future challenges for persons with disabilities in the sport?
One, thank you for serving. Everybody always say it's not disability, it's ability. And I always counter that with, your disability is what you make it to be. Mm-hmm. If you say, oh, I'm never gonna, you get injured and, you have a bad mind state and you just, I'm never gonna do this again, that's gonna happen. That's gonna be, it all starts with your mind, always say a body was made for love and not fighting, but a mind was made for fighting, and a body follows our mind. It all starts with your brain. You can't talk. You can't do anything without your brain. And it all starts right there. If you gotta have it, like I just said earlier, it's all about your effort and your attitude. For example, like back in October, I broke my foot. Now, normally it would take about 10 weeks to recover from what I had. I had to get surgery and everything, but I came back in almost four to 5 weeks. All because I had a mentality that I'm gonna come back faster than anybody ever came back. I worked hard. I just controlled my attitude and I controlled my effort. There's nothing I can do about my foot. They put a pin in there, I can't make it heal faster. I'm not gonna try to control anything that I can't control. I'm not gonna control what she can do because I can't do that. But I can control how I feel about my effort on the field, or my effort getting back to perfect, or getting back to where I want, whatever my dream is, and my attitude. It all starts with your attitude. And on top of that, like you said, your support system. Nobody truly wants to work with somebody who has a negative attitude, who has a bad attitude. You go into a rehab place and and you got a bad attitude, yeah, they're gonna try to help you, but there's only so much that they can do. Mm-hmm. It all starts with you. And there's no secret to it at all, like, oh, this is how you overcome it, this is how you get it. Everybody here is different. Everybody here has different problems. Everybody here has different path. You just have to find it by keeping the right attitude and keeping the right effort. And that's how I get through my life. That's how I know that in the future, whatever there is, that if I focus on those two things, I know everything else is going to take care of itself.
And I would just like to say thank you, Derek. I relate to you so much. And you're 24 years old. That's the amazing thing to me, what you know
thank
and
him.
What you understand. very impressive.
25.
He's 25, yeah.
No, it's okay.
I'm 25, okay. And I only want to add just one thing. The gentleman talked about what are some of the barriers. Some of the barriers, I think, are perception, right? How do you get over that perception? And Derek really touched on it. It's really effort. You really have to show people what your abilities are, because they're going to make certain assumptions. And we almost have to work, you almost have to work twice as hard a lot of times to overcome some of those perceptions of people, folks with disabilities. So I would say just double your efforts. Talk to people. A lot of times it's if they don't know you, those are some of the biggest obstacles. And Derek will tell you, coming out of college, going to the pros, a lot of the coaches had a perception of what his abilities were. And so a lot of the coaches passed on him because of that perception. Now, if anyone has seen him play, they know he can play, right? Better than most. But if there's that perception barrier, so what Derek had to do was work twice as hard, to prove himself.
Mm-hmm. That's right, and that applies all across the board. The attitudinal barriers are the biggest challenge, and sport, because it's something that the general public sees and watches and witnesses and celebrates, they come together to really participate in sports activities, and it's a great arena to demonstrate ability and to try to really, temper some of the tendency to have a perception that's negative about someone with a disability.
And then last thing, you studied, so you know exactly how it is. You guys are all working together in harmony, and you got a whole platoon of guys who never met each other, but you guys went through the same pain, you guys went through the same trial and error, you guys going through the same thing. You guys go overseas, you go to war, whatever it is, you guys are going through it all together, you know, because you guys all made a commitment, you know, you guys made a commitment to each other. That's the same thing that, you know, when you see another, like my dad said, you got to talk to people, because everybody has problems. Like, we can talk, I probably can stand in her office and talk like for 3 days, probably more than that, mm-hmm. you know, because we don't even have to know each other, but we made a commitment to make each other's life better because we know what we went through. I can just look in her eyes and I can know, but it's just a commitment to each other, and that's what you got to do. And since you find that person, it's the automatic, it's, you don't even have to say anything. It's the, as soon as you make eye contact, you know, like, I'm committed to make your life better, so you, and you're committed to make my life better, because we know what we've been through. I know what you've been through, and you know what I've been through. You have no idea what it's really like to have hearing loss, but you know what it's like to, you know, people say, oh, you can never walk again, or people say, you can never do this, or you can never do that. You know that, and you can apply that. And it's very simple like that. And that's what makes us all great. But people don't really think about it that simple. They're trying to make it a lot more complex than it really is.
So when I saw that he went to UCLA, I went to UC Berkeley, and I thought, oh, that's great.
You went to UC Berkeley?
Uh-huh. See? That's where we went.
Is there another question from our audience? Yes, Chingyu.
Thank you. I'm Chingyu Chen with Shanghai Media Group. I have a question about failure. Because, Derek, you were not drafted in the very first place. Mm-hmm. Why you keep trying? And have you thought of, like, stop pursuing? What made your mind?
I wanted to bat. I wanted to do it. No, you can ask everybody in the room. It doesn't even have to be me. You know, you talk about back when you was a kid and you really, 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 really wanted something. Like you wanted that new pair of shoes, you wanted that basketball, or you wanted the Barbie doll, or you wanted whatever it is you wanted. You did whatever you possibly could, whether you failed or not. He just talked about trial and error, but he didn't give up. You know, when you really want something, you won't give up. You know, I was just fortunate enough over at the White House. Who was it again? You remember Labor, Secretary of Labor?
Perez.
Yes.
Yeah.
Perez.
Yeah. Yeah. He was there, and he said he went to the Wounded Warriors, and he saw a shirt that says, "I cannot fail. It's not in my DNA." And that's a military thing, because I can fail. I know that, but all I did was take that fail out, and then I cannot quit. It's not in my DNA. I don't want to quit. You know, when you quit, that's the regret. And I was once told by my best team coach back when I was in college, there's nothing more painful than the pain of regret. Shoulda, woulda, coulda. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to have that. So I'm gonna do whatever I possibly can. If I know that I can't do it, it's because I basically, okay, you know, maybe I have to go a different route. I did everything I possibly could. You know, it just didn't pan out. But just, I know there's something else. So I'm gonna find something else. It's because I did, not because anybody else did. You know, we all wouldn't be here unless we failed at something. Nobody in the world has been 100% of everything. If somebody has, please introduce me to them. You know, and they can tell you the same thing. Like she really, really, really wanted to win. That's why she had the gold medal. She really, really, really wanted to teach. And then she passed it on. She was the blessing that kept on blessing. You know. So my dad really, really, really. My dad failed at trying to beat me tennis. He don't want to do it anymore because he might tear a hamstring. Yeah. You know. But it's the competitive nature in us. It's the competitive nature in all of us. We don't want to quit when we really want to do something. You know, it's just not in our DNA.
Fantastic. I think we have time for another question.
Hi, I'm Asiya Mason. Thank you so much for having this discussion. Aaron, thank you for organizing it. Derek, I have actually an invitation. I just got a grant from the State Department. Thanks for work that Judy have done in advocating for youth with disabilities to bring deaf and hard of hearing role model to Bali and Jakarta. And I was looking for an athlete, a deaf athlete, to go with me because I have a deaf lawyer, I have a deaf doctor already signed up, I have a deaf person at the White House. Uh-huh. I was thinking I need a deaf athlete to go with me. So
First, I'm not deaf, I'm hard of hearing, so you got a hard of hearing athlete.
It's for deaf hard of and hard of hearing so that they can see that deaf represent many, many backgrounds, many, many different abilities. And so I'm going to be talking to you and your dad after this.
The funny thing is, I actually, if I ever meet another disability person and voice, I actually want to team up with them because I know that they're going to work twice as hard as everybody else. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get something taken away from you, you tend to appreciate everything in life. When you have everything, you take it for granted. We all have. You know, we all taking something for granted. But when you get it taken away, you're like, wait a minute. That don't feel good at all. You know, you don't have something, you do whatever you possibly can. You work hard. It's just natural to you. You know, everybody here, everybody sitting on it, it's just natural. When, like, it's just natural for me to have to pay attention. You know, pay attention twice as hard. You guys may be able to relax in the classroom, hear the teacher, take notes. I'm the one that has to be extra proactive. You know, but do I think about it? No, because it's just naturally there.
I find over and over again, people with disabilities are really good problem solvers. Mm-hmm. We learn how to solve problems and how to look several steps ahead mm-hmm. of what's coming mm-hmm. so that we can adjust and adapt in every situation, on the sidewalk, wheeling to work, mm-hmm. Whatever it might be. So, and I also find that for me, having role models, mm-hmm. Women role models who are successful professionals. When I went to Illinois, women with disabilities who were in graduate school or getting ready to start their first job, mm-hmm. or women who were Paralympic gold medalists, you know, those role models were so important. And I know you're a great role model for all the young people in this country.
And you don't have to be an athlete. You don't have to be the president. You don't have to be somebody in a position of power to be a role model. Mm-hmm. You know, just you doing the best that you can be, showing everybody that I can function in this world without, you know, with a disability. She could function in the world if she came. I can't even imagine that, you know? But look at it. She's sitting up here having a conversation with us. You know, she's been through far more than I have. And
only because I'm older.
When I get your age, we'll compare. But, you know, we all just want to have fun. Now, everybody here just want to be able to relax and just enjoy life. So just why make it harder than it should be?
Thank you so much. Okay. And I think we have another question.
Hi, everyone. My name is Shen Chi. I'm a disability rights advocate in the tri-state area. I have a question for Derek. And so I want to ask you, Curious. There he is coming. it's been deaf, a disability issue? Yes
no,
or no?
It's who I am. I don't know what it's like to hear. You know, this is actually, don't ask me to ask that. You got it when you were 15, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Is being paralyzed a disability to you? So you knew how to walk and then lost it.
Yeah, I identify as a disabled person, and because that's my experience now. I had 16 years of experience as a non-disabled person, mm-hmm. and that's a great reference point for me. Mm-hmm. But I am very comfortable as a woman with a disability, as an athlete, as a professional working at the State Department.
And for me, the issue of disability is a political issue. Mm-hmm. Because just like the women's movement, the Asian movement, the African American movement, civil rights, human rights movements, we identify as something. So for me, the term disability is not euphemistically people talking about what I can't do. I know what I can't do, I can't walk. But for me, using the word makes a statement to other disabled people about this being a political movement, a movement for removing barriers.
Exactly. The reason why I asked you a question about the word, the negative impact on you, because it seems like the deaf community receives disability, the word, it's the negative impact on them. They rather not be classified, justify themselves as disability. And that was an issue. I was just out of my correction asking you if disability is a negative.
I never looked at it. It probably is a negative for some people, but I never look at it that way. You know, I don't, yes, I can't exactly hear well. When a lot of everybody starts talking to him, I'm going to have a very hard time. But I never look at it that way. I look at all the positive that come out of it. I'm able to turn my hand on and off whenever I want. You start, you know, things get loud in here, or I want to sit right here while you guys talk and take a nap, I can take my hand off and be out. You know, if somebody start making fun of me, I can easily just turn my hand off and walk away. That's actually going to make them mad. You know, I look at all the positive things that can come from it, and it's just, you know, and I don't, if you start focused on the negative, it's going to be depressing. You're not going to like it. Just don't worry about the negative. Just worry about the positive of it or what you can make of it.
Maybe I have to rephrase the question. Do you think that, do you identify yourself as a person who is deaf, is a disability?
No. I just identify myself as a person who just want to have fun and enjoy life.
And I think we have one question in the back.
Hi, I'm Robin. I just wanted to quickly ask Derek Jr. and also Anne as well. You talked a lot about your effect on kids and the work you've done with kids in the sports community. But I wanted to know, especially in the football community, because so many of your colleagues have nonprofits as well, have you also become sort of a hero to them? And have they come to you because, you know, just to ask questions about your disability, have they come to you and said, you know, can you advise on this? And because we're doing events with kids and that kind of thing. And has that changed your relationship with say, guys on other teams and so on and so forth?
It's actually back in January, I actually hosted a camp just for military kids in Fort Lewis, which is in Washington. It's one of the biggest bases in the United States, especially on the West Coast. And it was just for military kids only. Now, one of my other teammates, Jermaine Curtis, his foundation is specifically on military families because he comes from military families. You know, I believe his dad was in the military. He hopped around a little bit, and I remember talking to him, and we was just like, it's all the same thing. He had to overcome a lot of things. Just he couldn't really make friends that easy because his dad was hopping around bases. He probably kept a friend for two or three years, then he had to go make some new ones, and that's hard, especially as a kid. You know, even as an adult, we don't want to have to make new friends every three years. You know, and it's. We all come to each other because all of our foundations are connected somehow. Majority of them have to do with kids. Majority of them have to do with military families. You know, I just got back from Minnesota where I met the Holyfield.
Yeah.
And his is the same way. His foundation, sort of, you know, bringing like family and all that to the military, making them, you guys are just like everybody else. You know, there's nothing different. You know, you guys just have parents or loved ones who just are really selfless in putting themselves for the great nation, you know, and really all of it is just connected. And we all bond when it comes to that. Like, there may be a guy, I don't know, I don't really have a guy I don't like on the team, but let's say it was, but he had a foundation, like, I would still bond with him because that is, it's bigger than what we are. You know, yeah, we play football on national television, Super Bowl and all that, but what we're giving it to these kids and our foundation is a lot bigger than all that. So That's what I'm saying. We all know we have to be the blessing that keeps on blessing.
Well, thank you so much. Before we close, I would like to say...
I just wanted to respond to that question.
Please, Anne, please. Yeah.
Sorry. I just wanted to say that the Paralympic movement was a really special experience for me as an athlete and continues to be a place where I'm very involved, you know, in a volunteer leadership capacity. But the desire to share information about our sport, about how we train and compete and what type of sports equipment we use and everything was really important. You know, even in a really highly competitive arena, we want to see opportunities grow and develop, and we know that's going to happen when our sport is at its best. And, you know, people are enjoying it, everybody in the general population. So, and one of my favorite things to do is mentor other folks who are coming along who have an interest in, you know, staying involved or working in the sports industry as a person with a disability after their sports career is over. So those are some things that I feel really strongly about and appreciate having the opportunity to be involved with. So.
And it's not also, it's not just what, like she just said, just sharing the information. Like some guy come to me, oh, what helmet do you use with your hearing? That's the fourth one. Now, they have this building, they're in the working world, they're in the political aspect. If I wanted to go in political, I wanted to find out how, I would go and talk to them, you know, and we would bond. How did you do it? You know, how, I would ask her, how did you guys do it? How did you get into politics? How did you do what you do? Because I want to know too. Mm-hmm. Because I know those same barriers that they have to overcome or go around, I'm going to probably have to go through the same thing. You know, so sharing and caring.
Well said, Derek. And I wish that we had more time because I know that this panel of distinguished experts and role models could continue this conversation. And we look forward to doing that. But for today, I want to thank each and every one of you once again for coming together with us here at the Foreign Press Center to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. And we look forward to welcoming you back in the future. And thank you as well to our audience. And with that, we are now off the record. Thank you.